So this slide illustrates what EEG is all about and where the EEG is coming from. And what we know, there are billions of neurons inside our brain. If you want to map or measure a single neuronal response, and EEG or MEG is definitely not your choice. And to my knowledge, I do not believe there is currently any single non-invasive neuroimaging technology can accomplish that goal. What people do is you have to put an invasive probe and or sensor and to record a single neuronal activity. But if we talk about the human brain mapping, or if you want to look at the entire human brain activity, and what you can measure from electrophysiological sensors, such as EEG sensor or MEG sensor, is something we call the synchronized neural network response. In other words, all these single neurons, if they do not fire and synchronously, they will be filtered out by EEG recording, such as a coffee filter. You filter out undesired, unnecessary information. What you get is a large network responsibility and response which corresponding to the brain function. So in that sense, here is we know there's pyramidal cells which are lining up synchronously. If they fire synchronously, that will generate large enough neuronal current density flowing perpendicular to the local curvature. And if in a global sense, in the physics terminology, we know there will be neural current density distribution located inside passive volume conductor. And that current flow inside the volume conductor generate EEG as electric potential, MEG as magnetic field. So I want to use one specific example to show that how such kind of neural electrophysiology can help us understand the brain, and in this particular case, the conscious perception. So basically what we have here is, it's some study called the binocular rivalry study. We present one is a red, one is a green, and the two stimuli simultaneously to the two eyes of human subject. The human subject at any single time point, on the other hand, they will perceive either seeing the red or seeing the green. They do not see both at the same time. And this EEG is going to map out the brain response corresponding to that conscious and that perception. Now, of course, the EEG is a low resolution in the space domain, so by solving the source imaging problem, we can map out and this cortical activation corresponding to and this EEG recording. Here you can see that this is just show the two chart, one is green, one is red, and this segment just show the green perception and this segment show the red perception. If you look at in the time domain, after one single conclusion was drawn from this electrophysiology study is that when subject paying attention, then you can see the counter phase modulation and between these two rivalry stimuli. And but if a subject do not pay the attention, such kind of rivalry is not going to show up. Here just to show that if in the space domain we can map such kind of electrical and activity response as well. Here is a counter phase and modulation in attended rivalry, and if unattended, and the rivalry, such kind of phenomena disappear. So from this very simple example, we can see that although the spatial resolution is limited, however, their temporal resolution or the dynamic mapping and the capability of EEG does provide something very meaningful to us. There is one body of the work which has been pursued by a number of laboratories in the world in the past 10 years, that is, that we can moving from sensor domain to the source domain, in the sense that EEG is no more electrophysiology, it's no more time domain signal, it's no more a topography. We can turn EEG and similarly MEG into something we call three-dimensional tomography or neuroimaging by modeling the source and volume conductor and then solving the inverse imaging problem. So here I show the concept that we start from a non-invasive sensor array over the scalp, currently the commercial device. And there are thousands and thousands of devices available in the world and keep being purchased by a lot of research laboratory. And one of the things is that this EEG recording is no more new. So the recording technique is no more new. However, their innovation exists in the integration of electrical information with anatomical constraint and aided by the T1-weighted MRI and anatomical information. So from here, we can see we can from EEG in the sensor domain and map to the and inside the source domain and to do this functional source imaging. This slide illustrates how the progression of the EEG and as started as what we know, Hans Berger discovered EEG in 1920s. At that time, he put the electrode, you will see it's a time signal or the one-dimensional and the fluctuation responding to mass response of the neural network activity inside the brain. And then their field has progressed by putting multiple electrodes over the scalps to do this and topographic mapping, and then nowadays we are able to image the source distribution corresponding to, in this case, the visual evoked potential, which is, you can see in the visual and the cortex, and in the somatosensory evoked potential, then we are able to map the sensory and activity. So I will try to avoid the mathematical details in terms of how to solve such kind of source imaging problem, but and graphically, basically, we'll see when is to solve this problem, you need to do the forward modeling, you need to do the source modeling, and then need to solve a ill-posed regularization and signal processing technique and a problem. So there is a need for engineering innovation to solve such kind of problem, but the good news is that we have done a lot in the past to accomplish a much reasonable and spatial resolution from the EEG. So I will try to give some example in terms of clinical application to illustrate how we could use such kind of EEG source imaging and to map the brain. So one study, I know David mentioned that there's interest in NCAM about the pain and the quantification of pain imaging. And in this work, and we have done in our lab, is we did a controlled pain study by provide thermal stimulation to the subject. And we know the temperature, and then we ask the subject to provide a pain rating. And then we record the EEG. So we try to see if we could derive quantitative and objective biomarkers to quantify the pain level and try to image the neural network involved with the pain. So here on the left side is showing, first of all, this is showing the topographic map and corresponding to the pain after certain signal processing, because this is the pain perception is not like evoked potential. There is no latency. There's no peak in the evoked potential. You could say, okay, I'm going to just map this particular latency or this peak. It's ongoing activity, so we do need to extract the info, the component corresponding to pain. But then after we extract that component, we do the source imaging. You can see that actually this is very nicely corresponding to somatosensory, which is no surprise because that's how the stimulation was provided. In a group of 14 human subjects, what is interesting to us is the horizontal axis shows the subject pain rating, so ranging from 1 as the least pain and 10 to the most pain. Here is alpha rhythmic power change. So you can see that although variation do exist in the group of the 14 human subjects, but there it appears to be a reasonable correlation between the subject pain rating and their objective derived EEG biomarker in terms of how much pain the subject may feel. So this is one of the pilot study we are pursuing and at this time, and but this show one example how EEG could be used as a biomarker and as imaging the pain neural network.